reviewed this scenario over and over again, it seems to me a most exquisite mix of the ordinary and the extraordinary all thrown together. It's a great illustration of the lengths we will go to cling to the known rather than open our eyes and have to consider a new perspective. Kind of like the man from the cemetery on Friday who kept saying to me, "Yes, Father." There was a man born blind. On that point, everybody seems to agree. Indeed, they counted on that fact because he was neatly placed in the blind and helpless category so that everyone else was free to go about their lives. Society and daily culture then and now depend upon people first being categorized and then staying in their place. Jesus walked by and threw everything into confusion, apparently because he saw a human being when virtually everybody saw something else. For the disciples, the blind beggar was a theological dilemma. Was, they asked, his affliction an indication of his own sin, or rather was it something his parents did? Tell us, Rabbi. It's a familiar question, we all know it. Is that person's addiction her own fault, or is it a genetic precondition? I wonder, is this a question of morality? Or does it require a political and medical response? Or could it be, as Jesus suggests, that the need of one human being provides an opportunity for simple compassion? Simple compassion in the form of a most unorthodox intimacy. Touching the other. Not just brushing by, but attending to them a way a mother cleans her child with her own self, with her own saliva. Jesus dares to come up and come really close and really personal. A parent to a child. If for the disciples this guy is a theological specimen, for his neighbors he's a piece of scenery. They only know him if he stays where he belongs. We know him. He's a guy with the sign on the corner of Harper Road and Northern Parkway. But wait a minute, what happened to the sign? Must not be the same person. Is it? What do you think? Only after considerable speculation among themselves, you might notice, do they actually speak to this stranger who has been living in their midst, probably for the very first time. He speaks a simple truth. Yep, I'm the guy. The one you look past every day. Oh, what happened, they asked. Well, the man called Jesus made mud, I guess, and spread it on my eyes and said to me, "Go wash," and I did, and now I can see. Yeah, right, they say, still looking past him. So where is the guy? Where's the man? I mean, we know how things work, and there's some trick here. Then a third set of observers join the scene. The authorities, who standing before a miracle observe only an untrustworthy fraud, an accomplice in disrupting the peace, in trespassing the boundaries, in stepping out of bounds. Bring on the grown-ups, they say. His parents, who standing before a miracle, see only a problem and an indictment. We knew it before, when he was disabled. But now that he's a whole person, he's on his own. Ask him, they say, before they melt back into the crowd. A blind man, observed, becomes in turn a theological, philosophical, sociological question, a geographical signpost, a fraud and an accomplice, a problem and an indictment. For only one is he a human being, a fellow sufferer, a child of God, worthy of respect and compassion. Only one in this story, Jesus, can see from the very beginning. And only one, the acknowledged blind one, is willing to be healed of their blindness. The rest cling to it, and some miss the richness and the freedom that could be theirs. Last weekend, your vestry, your clergy, and several other members of St. Matthias went to a workshop entitled Seeing the Face of God in Others. Over 2 days, we, with our leaders, unpacked the demon of racism in this country and confronted us with the ways that we fine Christian folk are complicit in this sin. For most of us, it was the perfect Lenten exercise, one which could have actually taken its title from John chapter 9. The workshop entitled, "Surely We're Not Blind, Are We?" I began by describing this passage as comedy, appropriate for Laerte Sunday. But as it proceeds and blindness persists, the story becomes dark, darker, deep purple, the stuff of tragedy. But remember, Jesus, the light of the world, is in its midst. And so, there is indeed hope. It lies ironically, I think, in the Pharisee's final line. It is, by the grace of God, our line as we emerge from eye-opening workshops, from eye-opening worship, and say with wonder, "Surely, we're not blind." Or are we? Come, Lord Jesus, with your amazing grace, open our eyes to see the world, the creation, your people, your hand around us, that we may indeed see your face in one another.